just going to be filled with ball games, partying, and mindless stuff that doesn't matter in the end? Or do you want to discover the mysteries of the universe? Do you want to know what it is to truly be human and stand up for goodness and honor and decency and for the innocence? You know, the enemy teaches you there is no right and wrong. They teach you there are no heroes. But in your gut, you know that's a fraud. Many of you are not fulfilling your destiny to be heroes, but you are heroes. Somebody who puts aside their own petty personal gain to do what's right. And in the end, gains the world. Those that are willing to lay down their lives, gain their lives. Those that try to keep their lives and save their lives, lose them. Because when you've got a bunch of people who are cowardly, huddling and shaking, the tyranny, the wolves come. But when you're ready to fight and stand up and you know what's going on, tyranny evaporates like phantoms at dawn. I'm trying to remember the Thomas Jefferson quote about, if you just educate the whole of the public about liberty, then tyranny will vanish like phantoms at dawn. Let's go ahead and go to Paul Watson. All right, Paul, I'll shut up here. Go over the article that you've written. It's all over mainstream news. Well, we've already reported for years, but here it is, mainstream news. Top Nazis planned EU-style Fourth Reich. Then they founded Bilderberg, and now they admit they set up the European Union and the NAU, all of it.
Okay, well, what we already knew before these latest documents came out was this. As everybody knows, the first couple of years of the Second World War, the Nazis blitzed through Europe. They were on top. But from the early 1940s onward, the worm had turned and they knew that military defeat was all but certain. And so they started to devise ways of how they could preserve their power by means of consent over conquest. And it was during this period that top Nazis, such as Nazi economics minister Walter Funk, wrote about the necessity to create, quote, a central European Union and, quote, a European economic area. That's what Funk called for in his book, The European Community. As well as him, his co-authors, Nazi academic Heinrich Hunker, wrote in the same book, quote, classic national economy is dead. Community of fate, which is the European economy, fate and extent of European cooperation depends on a new unity economic plan. Also, fellow Nazi Gustav Koenig wrote, quote, we have a real European community task before us. I am convinced that this community effort will last beyond the end of the war. And that's
why they always say that the European Union, the engine of it's Germany, because the German taxpayers pay for it all. It's because you've got Krupp Industries and all of these guys who are right up there on par with the Rothschilds and others in the power structure. They literally suck all the money out of the German people to buy off the rest of Europe for themselves. It's just an economic domination.
Right. And then in following the release of this book, Minister of Propaganda Joseph Goebbels ordered the creation of, quote, large-scale economic unification of Europe, believing that, quote, in 50 years' time, people would no longer think in terms of countries. This was in 1940, and in 1993, just 53 years later, the European Union in its current form was born.
And so, Paul, that's why they're an irresistible force until you consciously realize what they're doing, because they move like a glacier. I mean, it's just that irresistible force. I'm going to twist you. I'm going to take my time butchering you real good. And the general public's thinking on a day-to-day, and the global masterminds, they're thinking on 50-year models. Go ahead.
Right. It's a long-term agenda. Other top Nazis who also called for the creation of pan-European federal economic superstate were Ribbentrop, Quisling, and Seyss-Inquart, who he spoke for, quote, the new Europe of solidarity and cooperation among all its people will find rapidly increasing prosperity once national economic boundaries are removed. And that could have been taken straight out of a CFR meeting or a trilateral commission meeting or whatever. So you've got all these top Nazis in the early 40s saying, we need a pan-European economic empire and we need to do it by consent rather than conquest. And then we'll get onto the new documents, which only solidify that this was taking place after the break.
Yeah, it's no doubt. The entire European Union to be the center of the new world government, as Gordon Brown has said, is to carry out Nazi policies of mass death. It's hard to believe that reality is what it is, but that doesn't change the facts. We are in a scientific dictatorship. And they are now moving to shut down free speech and resisting them verbally and physically. While they built the overall structure and bankrupted the societies to make us independent, make those of us that were independent dependent on them, they now move into the final phase of the hot war, or the physical tyranny, and that is now upon us. Your calls are coming up. Okay, Paul wants to continue with these articles you've got. We're Bilderberg Group's now in the news bragging, okay, we set it all up. Yeah, we really do run things. And, yeah, by the way, we're eugenicists, and this is what we want to carry out against the world population.
Right. I'll get to the Bilderberg connection in a second.
Yeah, continue with the Nazis. So they're saying by 41, 42, and yeah. You know, this was always the rumor. Well, no, people had read history books that had the documents. Then they would tell people, then folks would say, I heard, and then it became a rumor, that, oh, there was a secret Nazi plan to go underground, the crypto-eugenicists. Go ahead.
Yeah, so by 41, 42, they were saying it was necessary to roll their failing military agenda into a pan-European economic agenda. And the new revelations are that an author who was writing a book called Adam Labore was collecting material for a fictional book based around the premise that Nazis who were seeking to preserve their power and their money at the end of the Second World War conspired to create a Fourth Reich using the infiltration of creating a European Union, which we just talked about. And in researching and collecting material for this book, because obviously all such books are based loosely on historical fact, he actually discovered documents which directly proved the plot to be true. And this document is called U.S. Military Intelligence Report EWPA-128, and it's also known as the Red House Report. And in that document, it talks about how top Nazis met in Strasbourg, France, in 1944, knowing that they were about to lose the war, obviously, and they conspired to create a Fourth Reich based on a pan-European economic empire and a European common market. And what the plan consisted of was top Nazi SS officers like Dr. Schied ordered wealthy Nazi industrialists and bankers to set up front companies abroad and pose as reformed Democrats so that they could achieve economic penetration throughout Europe and ultimately lay the foundations for the reemergence of the Nazis. Now, this consisted primarily of people like Alfred Krupp of Krupp Industries and Friedrich Flick, according to these documents, as well as front companies that are still in operation today.
And now, elevators, coffee machines, car manufacturers. When you really know who the Nazis are, it's like everything you're looking at on store shelves that isn't Chinese.
Right. BMW, Siemens, Volkswagen, there's many others. And they were tasked with infiltrating the European business market and creating this foundation for the Nazi ideology to persist even after they were defeated militarily. And we've got a quote in the article from historian Michael Pinto Duchinski, who said, quote, for many leading industrial figures close to the Nazi regime, Europe became a cover for pursuing German national interests after the defeat of Hitler, The continuity of the economy of Germany and the economies of post-war Europe is striking. Some of the leading figures in the Nazi economy became leading builders of the European Union, end quote. Now, the key man in all this is somebody called Hermann Abs, surname ABS. Now, he was known as Hitler's top banker. And in fact, David Rockefeller, let me get the direct quote, called Abs the greatest banker of the 20th century.